Hello everybody, my name is Dr. Pow Jun Kai, and I'm going to present to you the research that I've been conducting for the NLB Digital Fellowship 2020. So my research generally concerns the intersection between music analysis and gender history. And for this particular research, it focuses on Southeast Asian culture. So the presentation today is separated into two parts. The first part deals with the changing conditions of early 20th century and late 20th century in terms of listening culture, musical practices. And the second part, we'll talk about the different gender characteristics of male singers, female singers, and cross-gender singers. So the topic that we are dealing with today concerns the lagu-lagu, or the songs that are being produced in the Malay archipelago during the late colonial period. These are the times when the British and Dutch imperial forces were in the archipelago. So how was the music created and circulated during the early 20th century? So an example of which is the recordings on this example of a shellac that we have here. This one particularly dates from 1928. So the singers and the artists comes from different walks of life, and they include stage actors, prize winners of competitions, as well as community leaders. We have the Hajis or the Ustas who also records their recitation on these shellacs recordings. As to where they come from, they include Bandung, Jakarta, Medan, Penang, and Singapore. These singers also range from different demographics, including age, class, gender, and singing styles. So for the first part of this presentation, I would like to speak about the changing conditions in which the music were being recorded on the shellac during the early 20th century. So I've identified three characteristics or conditions in which the singers and listeners during the early 20th century are exposed to the musical and auditory cultures. This includes the biological factors, the environmental factors, as well as the psychological factors. Okay, let's talk about the biological conditions during the early 20th century, which are very different from our present time. So life was much simpler and there was less industrialization during the period. The second factor is the environmental factor, where the circulation of information was less accelerated, it was slower, and for instance, the influences for the musicians came from travelers who takes months to come to arrive in Singapore, for instance, or they had to access the recordings from afar by traveling to different parts of Malaya or different parts of Java. Another example would be that the occasions where audiences could listen to music or could perform during the time range from a weekly to monthly basis. So it was very difficult to access musical performances during the earlier 20th century. This is very different from how in the 21st century we could just listen to music on demand. The third condition during the earlier 20th century is the psychological one, in which listeners and singers have a longer attention span. Concerts during the evening could spread to 2 to 3 hours. The artists practice has a different form of training in terms of musical delivery and musical rhetoric. They will use more dramatic action as well as articulate their singing in a different way, different manner as what we do today, because there was no microphones, there was no amplification, for instance. For the second part of this talk, I will work through the different singing styles of the performance from the 1900s, the 1920s, and the 1930s. So in the 1900s to the 1910s, this is during the pre-First World War period, a good standard of singing is maintained at a very stable and unwavering tone. So this is very different from what we hear today, where there are a lot of vibrato or a lot of exaggeration in terms of performing style. So for instance, there's a young girl, her name is Muna Kachil, and from what we hear today in the 21st century, her singing is weak and wobbly, and as well as her singing tone is dull and lackluster. But of course, we are listening to her singing in the 21st century's perspective. However, she remains a very popular singer because we can hear that she has many recordings to her name. From the 1920s onwards, there's this new phenomenon known as the male performer singing the female voice. So from our digital analysis, we can detect that they are in fact singing the falsetto range due to a very strong harmonic resonances. We can see that the waveform are very drastically spread out. Two of these cross-gender performers include Lee Cheng Kim as well as Lim Chu Sim. From a recording in 1929, Lee Cheng Kim sings from a very dramatic style because he belongs to the wayang stage, a form of Malay opera. Another recording that we have in 1934 is by Lim Chu Sim. He records his own singing on his own record label, and the repertoire that he chose belongs to the genre of the art songs, and he sings about fate and he sings about God, and he accompanies himself on the piano. So we can see from this range of cross-gender performances that the repertoire ranges from a vernacular style to the aristocratic stage. In the 1930s, the young native girls were very popular with the audience, and so record companies decide to capitalize on this phenomenon and records numerous young girls on Shellac records. So there's Miss Jema, who accompanies herself on the guitar, and there's the older Che Nolia, whose singing style is more pompous and forthright. And there's also a very popular young singer from Penang. Her name is Miss Mina. And her articulation from our analysis has been shown to be very refined and even-tempered. The singing style in the late 1930s became more active and more vibrant. So there's a competition champion from Singapore, Miss Julia. Her singing style is very versatile, as she tries to coordinate her singing with the backup orchestra. She's able to control her expression and control her tempo with the orchestra accompaniment. On the other hand, there's Miss Fadila with Filipino roots. Her singing has a tendency to scoop in and out of her phrases. So it's a technique which is known as portamento. So we can see that already from the female singers that in the late 1930s, there are a variety of singing styles apparent on stage. For the male singers on stage in the 1930s, they are more active in recording their voice and their artistry on shellac records. We have two examples here. One is S. Abdullah from Kuala Lumpur. He's a young Bangsawan actor, and we have recordings of him from 1934 to 1940. He has a rich tenor voice, and we found that his singing vibrato is highly even. Another competition winner from Singapore is A. Rahman. His voice is of the high tenor range, and when he sings, he has a very strong projection and is very well controlled. In terms of his melodic articulation, it is highly regulated. So all in all, what we can conclude here is that the listening public has been able to embrace and appreciate a diverse gender and musical talents in the early 20th century Malay popular music scene. Thank you. Thank you.